For our trip to Laos, we decided to go by train. The overnight journey took us from Bangkok to Nong Khai on the Thai-Laos border.
It's a good train and I'm sure a cockroach.
And from there, we went by mini van to country's capital, Vientiane. Officially, the country is known as Laos People's Democratic Republic and has a communist form of government with a president. According to international rankings, Laos is one of the world's poorest countries, and its geographic location, with no access to any sea or ocean, means that its economy cannot depend on exports of manufactured goods. Instead, the country has several large rivers, and a large part of its economy depends on the export of electricity generated from these rivers to its neighbor, Thailand, Vietnam, and China. In addition to electricity generation, Laos also has an abundance of minerals including coal, tin, gold, and copper, which drive the country's economy. Tourism has also increased rapidly over the past decade, and more than 2 million tourists generate more than $1 billion of revenue of the country every year. The history of modern-day Laos is tracked back to Lansang or Million Elephant Kingdom more than 700 years ago. Since then, after centuries of wars and raids by the Chinese, Burmese and Thais, the three separate regions of country Lansang, Lumphabang and Champasak eventually were reunited and fell under French rule from the late 1800s onward. Laos gained independence from France in 1953. But from the moment of independence until 1975, the country suffered from the internal strife as well as international proxy wars during the Vietnam War era. In 1975, communist forces finally declared their victory and established a government to rule the country. In 1997, Laos became the 8th member of ASEAN.
Welcome to Laos. So today we are in Kong River. So you just see it's kind of like to drown. So the water is going down. We can walk from here to Thailand because Thailand is another side of the river.
Since Laos is a landlocked country, and one of its major industries is electricity generation, we visit the National University of Laos to learn more about projects to electrify the country and generate electricity from wind, sun, and water. We first received an overview of the available resources and potentials for electricity generation within Laos, before we asked more specific questions about different projects and initiatives implemented by the Laos government to improve the country's infrastructure and the life of its citizens.
As you know, Laos, we don't have fossil energy resources, but we have renewable energy. We have very good hydropower potential. We have about 26,000 megawatt hydropower. The second type of renewable energy is solar energy. One of the priority is to electrify 90% of Laos household electrification by 2020. We have about 2,500 megawatt hydropower. Its capacity of this 82% we export. And you know how much we import? For 2012, we import 43% of hydropower from Thailand, from Vietnam, and from China. Why? Because the investment in Laos on hydropower development is by IPP, private company. They want to sell hydropower energy to Thailand. We have very poor people. They can earn less than $1.5 per person per day. Here, national poverty line. Now we still have about 20% people still lower than this in countryside. This one of the worry of our people is to big change. And Lao people like very quiet life, like countryside. And when the country developing, some people cannot follow the development change. But the government try to not to develop so fast. We step by step. If too quickly, people cannot follow the development.
Could you please introduce yourself, explain a little about your position, and talk about how you first got involved with renewable energy?
I am professor of the for renewable energy in National University of Laos. I have been dealing with renewable energy in Laos since 1994.
Why is Laos PDR developing renewable energy resource? Why now?
In Laos, we don't have traditional energy resources like oil, natural gas, but we have plenty of renewable energy resources like solar energy, hydropower, and biomass. That's why hydropower development is one of the priority of Lao government.
Do you think people in Lao consider climate change to be a major issue?
We are considering climate change issues in our economic development. That's why we try to develop hydropower is clean energy to supply to other ASEAN countries.
What are biomass and biofuels, and how are they different from traditional oil and gas?
Biomass is considering as carbon neutral, you know. When it's growing, it absorbs the CO2 from the air, but when we use it, release the CO2. That means no change in the CO2 balance of the atmosphere.
Why are they not used as much as traditional foods?
If we focus more on fuel production from food crops, that means problem with the food supply, of course.
Why is hydropower considered to be the most important energy resource for Laos?
As you know, we don't have others. That's why we have only hydropower, and we have plenty.
How has the Lao government support project in renewable energy, and how has this helped make sure project possible?
Now, Lao government has already developed renewable energy development strategy. Government would like to develop renewable energy, but the problem is renewable energy is still expensive comparing to traditional one.
Do you think it would be possible to expand some of this project to an ASEAN-wide or regional level? And do you think the ASEAN Secretary might help support some of these projects?
Of course, especially hydropower development in Laos get very important meaning for ASEAN countries to supply clean power to ASEAN network in the future. And we have close operation with ASEAN Energy Center, you know, ACE, in development of some renewable energy project in Laos.
Could you talk about some of the domestic challenge faced with renewable energy?
You know, Laos PDR is still very poor in terms of economic development. That means if we would like to try to develop our renewable energy resources, but we still lack of funding. So it's a big challenge for us.
How can we help raise public awareness for this issue?
I think young people can learn together, like your trip to our countries. That's very good. So you can learn more about our countries, and then the same, our students can come to your countries. We should learn each other more, and then we will have better understanding each other.
What is the Mekong project and why is it important?
In Mekong sub-region, mean people earning from $2 to $5 per day. This big group in new ASEAN member countries like Laos, Cambodia, and Myanmar. So in the future, this group of people will become very important in terms of energy consumption. So we would like to know the behavior of the energy consumption of them now and how will be changed in the future.
Laos is a Buddhist country, and much of the country's art and culture reflects the teachings and philosophy contained with Buddhism. We had some great opportunities to visit several important historical and religious sites in Vientiane, including the National Museum of Laos, which highlights the struggle of the people to free the country from foreign occupiers and imperialist forces in the 1970s.
So today we are in the kind of like the ancient dome for the model of hell, the hell, the people world, and the heaven. That being the site, like after we dead, we're gonna go to hell or heaven. So I'm on the heaven place, and if we go downstairs, we're gonna go to the people world and gonna go to the hill.
Buddha Park, the Buddhist themed park that in 1958, contains more than 200 Hindu and Buddhist statues. One of the main attractions is the round three-level structure that contains, as Sim explained, depictions of hell, earth, and heaven. Prakyao Temple, which was built around 1565, used to house the image of Emerald Buddha, which is now found in the Temple of Emerald Buddha in Bangkok, Thailand. Phathat Luang is probably the most important national monument in Laos, estimated to be approximately 1,700 years old. The large gold-covered stupa, located in the middle of Vientiane, has been rebuilt many times after invasions and destruction by the Burmese, Chinese, and Thais. Architecturally, the structure includes many references to Laos culture and identity. Sisaket Temple and Museum, which was constructed by the Siamese style with five-tiered roof instead of traditional Laos style. This temple housed more than 2,000 silver ceramic Buddha images along its cloister wall. And of course, we had a moment to make merit by releasing some birds. One of the most important things about national development is access to education. And while in Laos, we had an opportunity to speak to EDF, an organization that aims to help provide opportunities for education to the people of Laos, particularly in rural areas.
My name is Kham Hien Intawa. I'm the director of the Education for Development Foundation.
My name is Jamie Bunled, and I am fundraising manager.
What is the purpose of this project?
The purpose of the project is to help evaluate the poverty in Laos by providing education to the underprivileged children in the remote area of Laos.
What is some of the biggest challenges facing Laos school?
Some of the biggest challenges facing Laos schools are in the rural area, because that's where we work at, is lack of schools, quality of teachers. Those are the two important things, but we work in all areas in helping improve schools.
How does EDF now work to address some of these challenges?
We bring the support from outside, together work with the government of Laos to help to address the problem in the rural area.
Is poverty a problem in Southeast Asia?
I think yes. The poverty, especially in Laos, still 1/3 of the population are living under the poverty line, and this is a big challenge for the Lao country, for the Lao government to address.
Do you think better education would reduce poverty throughout ASEAN?
I believe the human resource is the most important issue. So education, the young generation, the new generation, is the most important aspect for the development of the regions.
Could you talk a little bit about the Student Scholarship Fund?
The scholarship project is provided for those students that are disadvantaged, that are very poor, and that are at risk of dropping out of schools. These students are wanting to learn, wanting an education, but because of poverty, and it's not their fault, it's because of the situation, they are forced out of school and working. So with scholarship project, we provide these scholarship to these students so that they can have a better future.
What kind of support does your organization need to continue doing your good work?
I think right now we have to focus on the quality of the education. So we would like to emphasize, besides the sponsorship to the children of underprivileged, we would like to emphasize on the building the capacity of teachers. So quality teachers equipped with good instruments may lead to the better learning and teachings.
So in the school has a library, yeah? So, how to make kids interested in reading?
That's a really good question. People may say in Asia, generally, children may not like reading. But I can say it's not that they don't like reading, but the key is they don't have the interesting material to read. What we try to solve is we will try to find more books, the more interesting topics, provide them with what they love to read.
How these people who are interested in your project, get involved in your project?
They can contact us. We have Facebook, so we have volunteer opportunities. If you're interested in a project, we will work with you and try to see what your needs are and try to accommodate that.
Does this school have the table or chair? I'll just say the dirt.
We do have chairs and tables, but broken down, and they squeeze together and sit and share the table and chairs. So they try to do what they can do with what they have.
Of course, no visit to any country is complete without a taste of local cuisine or an opportunity to learn about the country's culture and arts, including performance arts. We didn't expect it, but we had to remove our shoes before entering. While we enjoyed a wonderful dinner, we were also able to watch some of the traditional dances of Laos, which to us from Thailand seems very familiar, yet with a distinct difference from the dances we see in central Thailand. At the end of evening, we even had a chance to join in and show that we could dance.
Well, actually, we just did the Lao dance, which is like, you know, which is very similar to Thai dance. It's like the tradition here is very similar to each other between Thai and Lao, and we dance with the Loy Pa Thong song. This is the song when we dance in Songkran, in Loy Pa Thong festival, and yeah. So I used to learn Thai dance, so I'm able to dance.
EDF Lao, I think it's a very good organization. They help many poor children to get the opportunity to study and getting a better job and having a better education.
But I like the culture and language because it's easy to speak with them because they speak like simple Thai, but some of the words not same. Like Sawadee will be Sabaidee and Khopkun will be Khopjai.
I'll come back here because
I like their view and the trees, the forest, the landscape that look nice, and they have so much about for the jungle, the forest that I can go